The one you should not have killed is probably one of the most touchy subjects in FNAF lore. Everyone is so passionate about what they believe, and very few people are open to new ideas. Trust me, after nearly 300 FNAF videos, I know that people don't really care unless it's one of the big 3 or 4 FNAF channels. But that's why I'm coming in with the evidence, man! The true identity of the one you should not have killed is what we're exploring today. Greetings, gamers, and welcome back to Top 10 Gaming. I'm Connor Monroe, and this is the Top 10 Reasons Why FNAF Crying Child is the one you should not have killed. Let's do it. In a 10 possession. The main idea of possession in the FNAF universe is that you're around the object you're possessing, whether it be an animatronic, a toy, or a person. My question is, how would Crying Child have been around Golden Freddy if he dies in a hospital, as we hear thanks to the flatline at the end of FNAF 4? Cause like, it's either he's possessing William or Golden Freddy. So assuming the Crying Child dies in the hospital, as we're led to believe, how would Golden Freddy be close enough to actually get possessed? While yes, agony reaches out further from the body than any other emotion, it doesn't reach out that far. Not from the hospital to the pizzeria where you got your head squashed. The closest thing that we know ends up getting possessed by something is his father, which makes the most sense if he dies in the hospital. While you could argue that he died in Fredbear's mouth, there wouldn't be a need for IV, flowers, and pills, along with a heart monitor if he was dead from the moment that the animatronic bit down. So we know he didn't die in Fredbear's mouth. And at 9, limitations. We also see limitations of possessions other than actually being within proximity of the animatronic or object you possess. With what we've learned about agony and possession in the FNAF universe, nobody can really possess multiple large things at once. Sure, you can possess multiple small objects, as we see in the end of the man in room 1280, I believe is the story where that happens, but nobody has been able to possess multiple large or big ticket items like animatronics or people at once. This leads me to the conclusion that Cassidy and Crying Child have to be possessing two different things. Cassidy cannot be possessing Golden Freddy and William, and neither can Crying Child. So Crying Child is either Golden Freddy or the one you should not have killed. But we know that Cassidy is Golden Freddy thanks to the Happiest Day minigame Easter egg from the survival logbook. On the page asking about your happiest day, we can see the puppet giving a cake to a young girl with black hair. This same girl can be seen described in the FNAF novels and is named Cassidy. This combined with the Happiest Day minigame revolving around setting Golden Freddy's soul free indicates that Cassidy has been set free thanks to the good ending not showing the Golden Freddy head in the background. So, if she's Golden Freddy, Crying Child has to be possessing William. And it ain't Fredbear. One of the biggest points I see as to why Crying Child is Golden Freddy, or part of Golden Freddy, is because Fredbear gets turned into Golden Freddy. What? When was this mentioned? Because I don't recall this ever being a fact in the games, especially never confirmed. Like, it's just the theory that perhaps Golden Freddy was just Fredbear repurposed or something like that. However, if we're being honest, William would not have reused the animatronic that killed his son. Okay? He would have destroyed it. Plus, the shapes of Golden Freddy and Fredbear are way too different to actually have them be the same animatronic. Freddy's proportions are much smaller than Fredbear's because Fredbear is a springlock suit, so it would have to have enough room for a human and all the robot parts to be tucked away. Golden Freddy just doesn't have enough room for that, and it's a suit with no endoskeleton. So they cannot be the same animatronic. So Crying Child would either be Fredbear or the one you should not have killed, and Fredbear was nowhere near Crying Child when he dies in the hospital, unless they're just a really crappy hospital. And it's 7, Glamrock Freddy. This is definitely not the strongest point, but it's something that I felt like was worth mentioning anyway. The character of Glamrock Freddy in Security Breach is the first animatronic to help us not die in the series. And based on Funko statues, the animatronic's belly will open up and allow us to climb inside. This made many people compare Glamrock Freddy and Gregory to Crying Child and Foxy Bro. However, I don't think that this is actually a good example. I mean, I've done it myself, but I mean, let's be honest. Do Mike and his brother really have that good of a relationship? Do they seem like the kind of brothers to stick by each other's side like they're the Winchesters? Or do they look like they're the kind of brothers who would shove each other into animatronic mouths for a laugh, resulting in the brutal, albeit accidental, death of their younger sibling? Exactly. Instead, what if this hiding inside the animatronic thing is actually meant to be representing William and Crying Child? It could make sense, given that Crying Child would have thought his dad was trying to help him at first too, only to feel betrayed when he realized what was actually going on. And William is the only other character we know to have someone hiding inside them other than other animatronics. Just saying. And it's 6, Released. At this point, Cassidy's soul has been released following the events of the Happiest Day minigame. We can even see this be proven to us in the survival logbook, which revealed Cassidy's name. Since, like I said, on the page talking about your happiest day, we see the puppet giving cake to a little girl who was drawn exactly how Cassidy is described in the book series. And the FNAF 3 endings also support this, since in the bad ending we can see the light on in Golden Freddy's head, you know, the one light that splashes to both eyes, and in the good ending that light isn't on anymore. So while some people think that she's not at rest due to her head not being there, we couldn't see her head even if the light was on. Like, we could only see it from the inside. So it being there, just in pitch black, is totally plausible and honestly expected. That's just how light works, and it's stupid to ignore the basic laws of the universe. Sure, we can have possessed robots, okay, that's fine, but nothing about that is going to change how light works. Okay, that's too much, even for Five Nights at Freddy's. And they should really fix those damn doors, though. Halfway through and in at number 5, Andrew. The one you should not have killed ends up making an appearance in the Fazbear Frights books. Well, a version of the character does, since this one is named Andrew and is wearing an alligator mask. However, this version has way more in common with Crying Child than they do with Cassidy. Firstly, they're both male characters with dark hair. Secondly, Andrew at one point appears as a shadow as described in the story, and Nightmare and Ultimate Custom Night says, quote, "The shadow fears me," which could be what this moment in the book was referencing, since Ultimate Custom Night takes place during the events of the man in room 1280, only allowing William to wake up when he manages to survive. Either way, Andrew has more in common with Crying Child, which makes sense given that these books are meant to clear things up from the games so that we can move ahead with the lore. So the introduction of Andrew was clearly meant to demonstrate that Crying Child is the one you should not have killed. And at 4, he. When looking at Ultimate Custom Night, we find a lot of information about the one you should not have killed, since, you know, they were introduced. Lines that also refer to the one you should not have killed call him a he, which some wrote off as confusion because of the animatronic Cassidy inhabits, but there is no way that they would call a spirit by their animatronic gender identity, okay? They'd be a spirit, not an animatronic. This has always bothered me. Because if Cassidy was possessing both William and Golden Freddy, she would still want to be referred to as Cassidy when not inside Golden Freddy, especially if Cassidy is really as vengeful as we thought, since, you know, being called by the thing that you get stuffed into after being brutally murdered probably isn't gonna make a spirit too happy. Getting close to the end in number 3, Nightmare Animatronics. The appearance of the Nightmare Animatronics as well in Ultimate Custom Night is another indicator that the one you should not have killed is Crying Child. Since FNAF 4 ends with Crying Child dying, who else would know about the Nightmare Animatronics that are literally nightmares? Nobody. Especially not Cassidy. If Cassidy is the one you should not have killed, how would she have known what the Nightmare Animatronics look like to have them torture William in Ultimate Custom Night? She just wouldn't be able to. It wouldn't make sense. The presence of the Nightmare Animatronics in Ultimate Custom Night and after means that the one you should not have killed had to know what they look like. And since Crying Child saw them in a nightmare while in a coma and died after he saw them there, there is no possible way anyone else could know what they look like. They have a stomach mouth, probably because Crying Child saw Elizabeth get gotten by a baby, which would realistically make him fear the animatronics and the animatronic stomachs in case they also have a surprise claw that will eat you. It's just, you know, it's the only thing that makes sense. And if you think that FNAF 4 isn't a dream, click up in the top right corner because we have a whole video about that. And ultimately, in at number 2, literary symmetry. Just like how Chuck had Jessica die in the same way as Mary Winchester in Supernatural, it seems that Scott Cawthon is taking that same idea and applying it to Five Nights at Freddy's. Also, can you tell I've been watching a lot of Supernatural? Since if we think about it, Crying Child and William are both put in the same position in the respective games. FNAF 4 has Crying Child lying in a coma, dying in the hospital, and Ultimate Custom Night has William laying in a coma, dying in the hospital. But also not dying, because he's being possessed. Either way, they're both dealing with roughly the same thing, and I think that's why we got the man in room 1280, since Scott wanted to clarify that William wasn't in hell, but rather in a coma much like his son. It's great storytelling, and it's not something that you can say Scott wouldn't do. In fact, Scott probably thought about this as soon as FNAF 4 was released, and thought that that's how William would have to end as well. Death like your son, but make it a little spicy, you know? That's basically what Scott did, and it only serves as more evidence. There's no way it's a coincidence. Not in FNAF. In a fan base that is literally comparing hexadecimal color codes, There's no way that's a coincidence. Finally, in at number one, Ultimate Custom Night voice lines. Finally, we come to one of the biggest pieces of evidence I feel proves that Crying Child is the one you should not have killed. So it's pretty well established at this point that in Ultimate Custom Night, the death lines are just the animatronics repeating what the one you should not have killed says, as we can see with the mediocre melodies, because, you know, we can hear the one you should not have killed behind them. And the voice casting was supposed to work as a young boy or a young girl. However, a majority of these lines end up having something to do with Crying Child. This is even more pertinent since we don't know a lot about Cassidy, so these being personalized is a very important detail. And then we have the addition of lines like, I am remade, but not by you, by the one you should not have killed, and I have always been hiding in your shadow. And most importantly, let me put you back together and take you apart all over again. All of these are references to the Crying Child. I Am Remade references William's promise to put his son back together as his child. And as his child, Crying Child would be in William's shadow to hide, since his father would make him feel protected, at least at first. And I don't think that we need an explanation for Let Me Put You Back Together, which, I guess if you want one, is also a reference to that famous FNAF 4 line. But the thing is, how would anyone else know these things? Cassidy would have no way of knowing, and why would they talk about it if they did? Clearly, the one saying these lines has a bone to pick about this, and that person is Crying Child. There we have it, friends, the top 10 reasons why FNAF's Crying Child is the one you should not have killed. What do you think? Have I convinced you? Are you hashtag Team CC or hashtag Team Cassidy? Be sure you let me know down below. Thank you all so much for watching. I have been and shall remain Connor Monroe, and I'll see you in another video.